Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome in. Trevor Lane here for LakersNation.com with the latest Lakers trade deadline buzz, and we've got a lot to talk about today. Jovan Buha of The Athletic dropped an article that revealed a lot of tidbits. A lot of it confirmed some things that I have been hearing. Want to dive into all of it. Before I do, a quick reminder, do subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Turn on those notifications. I'm going to do everything I can to keep you guys as informed as possible heading into the trade deadline. All right, let's start right here. According to Jovan, teams that the Lakers talk to, this is not a surprise at all, but they're largely asking for Austin Reaves and a first-round pick in any type of trade negotiation. Now, again, not a surprise. We were hearing this last year. Russell Westbrook, remember what the discussion was then? It was that just taking on Russell Westbrook, getting him off the Lakers roster would cost a first-round pick, and if the Lakers actually wanted anything back in a deal that was playable, that would be another first-round pick. We know how things actually played out last year. This time of year, teams are asking for a lot, and they will get more realistic as we get closer to that February 8th trade deadline. But nonetheless, right now, the Lakers talking to teams, they want Austin Reaves and a first-round pick for pretty much everything. Again, makes sense. That's the way it is this time of year, but expect those prices to come down as we get closer to that trade deadline. Remember, the best two assets the Lakers have are Austin Reaves and that 2029 first round pick. At least that's how opposing teams see them. Now, D'Angelo Russell, Gabe Vincent, and Rui Hachimura, according to Jovan, are all viewed as neutral assets at best, meaning teams are not going to give you a whole lot in order to get these players. Might even be negative assets to where they would think the Lakers would need to give them something in exchange for taking these players, depending on the team. Obviously, it's all in the eye of the beholder. So depending on the team, you may have to actually give something in order to get teams to take these players, which for D'Angelo Russell, I get it, right? Because it's a tough spot to be in. He's got a player option this coming summer. So either he continues playing the way he has recently, which has been fantastic, and he opts out, and then you have to pay him more money. That's not a good spot to be in if you're an opposing team. Or he goes back to the slump that we saw in December. He's playing terribly. He opts in, and you've got that money sitting on your books for next year. That lack of control is an issue for teams. So it's not a surprise that D'Angelo Russell doesn't by himself carry with him a lot of value. Rui Hachimura, let me say this. I like Rui. I think Rui's a good player. I think he's on a good contract. If teams around the NBA are saying we're giving him zero value, we're not going to give you anything for him, then keep him. Then keep him, especially if the Lakers start to feed him more minutes, maybe more minutes even than Torian Prince. Just a thought. Then I think Rui Hachimura will have positive value before long. If right now teams are saying, no, we're not, he's a negative value even, get out of here. No, then don't trade him. That's my opinion, but then don't trade him unless it's a crazy deal that you can't turn down. I think Rui Hachimura is on a fine contract, and if he gets the minutes, he'll have no problem being a positive value player in the future. Gabe Vincent, big question mark. I totally get it here. Why teams would not want to give him positive value. He hasn't played this season, essentially. He's played five games, and we don't know how his recovery is going to go with this knee issue. Hopefully, he's back. My best guess is he'll be back sometime after the All-Star break, but Gabe Vincent needs to be on the floor in order to have value. So that one, I get as well. The Lakers specifically, what are they looking for? They're looking for three things. And actually, Jovan and I talked about this yesterday on the Lakers Nation podcast. It published here on the YouTube channel this morning. Looking for three things, and actually three things in this order. They're looking for speed and athleticism in their backcourt, which makes sense. D'Angelo Russell, Austin Reaves give you neither of those things. Both good players, but they just don't give you speed and athleticism. Specifically, the Lakers are looking for a point of attack defender. Boy, wouldn't Alex Caruso do wonders in that kind of a role? They're also looking for a two-way wing player, perhaps like a Dorian Finney-Smith type player who can come in there, defend multiple positions, shoot the three. We've talked all about this here on this show, that the Lakers, one of their problems is they have a lot of one-way players, guys who either play offense and don't give you much on defense or vice versa. They need guys who can do both, and so a two-way wing makes sense as a target, though I would contend that Rui Hachimura probably just needs some more minutes because I think he can be a two-way wing. Not that he's a great defender, but he's passable. He's not like a non-defender either. The other thing they're looking for is a backup big. And again, it's in that order. So backup big would be the lowest priority. Highest priority would be a point of attack defender. I do think a backup big is a very realistic get for the Lakers too. just looking at some of the names that might be out there. We talk about Daniel Gafford, Nick Richards. Those are two younger players that would make a ton of sense for the Lakers to go get. Might cost you a little bit more, though. But could you get in on, say, like an Andre Drummond or someone like that with Chicago? Maybe there's something to be done there. If you just need somebody that can come in that's not going to demand starter minutes or be upset if they don't play in a particular game, because you know Christian Wood is going to get minutes as well, and he's going to get his opportunities. But you need somebody who's a true physical presence, a shot-blocking threat at the rim to a greater degree than Christian Wood. So you've got that skill set to call upon. There's going to be games where Christian Wood's going to be the right decision. His three-point shooting is what you're going to need in the game. But I think it would be nice to also have that true physical backup big on the roster as well. Jovan said the Zach LaVine chatter has really died down, which again, the Lakers, they don't want to take on that long-term salary. I've been saying it for months now. If you want the Lakers to get Zach LaVine, you have to be committed to Zach LaVine being the guy for this team moving forward, the guy that you want to put next to Anthony Davis. If you're not 100% convinced that that's what Zach LaVine is, and I think it's fair to not be convinced, then it doesn't make a lot of sense to trade for him with how much money you're putting onto the books and how much you're encumbering your future moves if you do that. I also mentioned that the Lakers prefer a deal to land DeMar DeRozan and Alex Caruso. Now, math-wise, if you're going to get both of them, DeRozan and Caruso, you're talking about $38, $39 million in salary coming back in. You'd have to stack up D'Angelo Russell and Rui Hachimura essentially in order to get there and make the math work on a deal like that. So something to consider as well, but that is the preferred duo for the Lakers out from Chicago. Not saying that's the duo they're definitely trading for, but they would rather go after those two players than Zach LaVine. So important to note there. Now, the Dejounte Murray trade talks, this is the big one, right? Because Dejounte Murray, one of the biggest names left out there on the trade market. Other names may pop up between now and February 8th, which again is that trade deadline. But Dejounte Murray, the biggest name out there. Jovan says the Lakers and the Hawks had talks, and there was some optimism that it may get done. This goes along with everything that I was hearing as well. The Lakers thought potentially they had a deal without Austin Reaves. Actually, I shouldn't say they had a deal. They believe there could be a deal without Austin Reaves involved. And what I also heard was that the deal included D'Angelo Russell. Jovan adds a little bit more to that, saying that the Lakers offered D'Lo, the 2029 first, and JHS, and they were hopeful that they could get a deal done there, plus other draft capital. So that would mean either second-round picks or pick swaps that the Lakers could throw in. But the Hawks, they would like to get, obviously, Austin Reaves, and so talks have stalled out, but they are expected to pick up talks again before the trade deadline. I get it from the Atlanta Hawks perspective. The Atlanta Hawks are going to want to go and see what else is out there on the market. That's not a deal that necessarily blows me away if I'm the Hawks. Now, Michael Scotto of Hoopsype yesterday mentioned that the Lakers in this scenario would actually have to send D'Angelo Russell to a third team. So that complicates things even further because the Hawks don't want to take on that future salary for D'Lo in the event that he picks up his player option for next year. So that is another complicating factor. If this would need to turn into a three-team trade, that becomes that much more difficult to pull a deal off. Again, for the time being, trade talks have stalled, but they are expected to pick up again. Last I heard from the Lakers side of things, the Lakers don't want to wait for Atlanta. The Lakers aren't going to wait around forever for Atlanta to field a bunch of different offers and then say, okay, well, we'll beat the best offer or something like that. The Lakers are going to look at other targets as well. They're not going to just sit on the sideline and wait for Atlanta to figure things out and figure out whether or not they're willing to accept the deal without Austin Reaves. My sense from the Lakers side of things is that the Lakers won't do a deal if Austin Reaves is involved. Who knows? Maybe Atlanta comes back and blows them away and says, Bogdan Bogdanovic and Dejounte Murray in a deal if you can put Reaves in. I don't know specifically if it is, but maybe that's enough to get the Lakers to say yes. But from everything I've heard, it sounds like the only way the Lakers do a deal with the Hawks is if Austin Reaves is not involved, and the Hawks want Reaves. So we'll see if anybody blinks there in that negotiation. Jovan also mentioned that the Lakers will have interest in Bruce Brown if the Raptors decide to flip him. Now, he's got a really interesting salary. He makes $22 million this year. Next season would be at $23 million, but it's a team option. So the potential is there if the Lakers needed future flexibility. If you wanted to swing a trade for Bruce Brown, you could trade away pieces that have salaries going into next year, get Bruce Brown, and then decline his team option if you really wanted to, and off you go. What would the Lakers offer in that situation? Again, you're probably looking at something built around D'Angelo Russell. Do you get another point guard back? Bruce Brown is a two. He can handle the ball a little bit, but you'd be losing D'Angelo Russell's playmaking in that scenario. Or could you build something with, say, Rui Hachimura and a piece to make the money work? That's another thing that you could look at. But again, just the Lakers are going to have interest. Nothing specific out there yet, but they'll have interest in Bruce Brown if he's made available. We've also heard the Knicks are going to have a lot of interest in Bruce Brown if the Raptors decide to flip him. And then last thing, Jovan just provided a list of players the Lakers are interested in or talked about. Keep in mind that this time of year, and really all year, it's the front office's job to have discussions about a lot of different players. So this doesn't mean they're going and getting these guys, but these are some specific names that he's heard that have come up. And that is Jerami Grant, Terry Rozier. So Jerami Grant from the Blazers, big, big salary there. And he's turning 30 in March. So kind of like Zach LaVine, you've got to be pretty convinced he's the guy that you need moving forward if you're going to go get him. Terry Rozier from the Charlotte Hornets has had a great year for them. Gary Trent Jr., Dorian Finney-Smith, and Royce O'Neal as all guys the Lakers could target. I know Sean Davis here on Lakers Nation is a big fan of Dorian Finney-Smith and going and getting him. I think Royce O'Neal could make some sense. Gary Trent Jr. for the Raptors as well, if they're ready to make a move. And it sure looks like he's a guy they could put on the trade market. So lots of potential options out there for the Lakers and a lot going on the trade front. But once again, you know, we're going to keep you up to date with everything going on the trade market for your Lakers. Make sure you hit the subscribe button. Don't forget to turn on those notifications. Till next time, everybody. See ya and stay safe.